Myself, I am Gunakar, Assistant Professor of Zoology, Government Degree College, Siddipet, Telangana State. Today, let us take up the Scolyodon respiratory system. Before going into the details of Scolyodon respiratory system, let us have a look at the systematic position of the Scolyodon. Scolyodon is commonly called dogfish or common Indian shark. It belongs to the phylum Chordata because it has notochord, dorsal hollow central nerve cord, and as well as gill slits. It belongs to the subphylum Vertebrata as its notochord is modified to become vertebral column. It belongs to the superclass Gnathostomata as it possesses jaws. It belongs to the class Chondrichthys because it has cartilaginous skeleton. Endoskeleton is cartilaginous and has ventral mouth, and the gills are not covered by operculum, and the presence of heterocercal tail. All these features supports the Chondrichthys class. It belongs to the order Pleurotremata as it has laterally compressed body as well as lateral gill slits. Along with that, pectoral fins are not too large and not too small, they are moderately sized. And the tail is not clearly marked from the trunk. Then it belongs to the family Carcharinidae as it has well developed nictitating membrane. Its scientific name is Scolyodon. That means it belongs to the genus Scolyodon because spiracles are absent and teeth are non-serrated with swollen bases. And it belongs to the species Sorakova as the base of the anal fin or posterior ventral fin is more than twice the length of the second dorsal fin or posterior dorsal fin. I repeat, why it is named as Sorakova? The base of the anal fin, which is also called posterior ventral fin, whose base is more than the twice the length of the posterior dorsal fin or second dorsal fin. Next, now you can see the Scolyodon respiratory system, the figure as it is. We will look into the next aspect, the Scolyodon respiratory system. The Scolyodon respiratory system can be studied under two heads. One is the structural aspect and the functional aspect. In structural aspect, what are the structures we shall see in the Scolyodon respiratory system is the respiratory organs, which are none other than gills. There are five pairs of gill slits. Gills are present in the Scolyodon, and the respiratory tract is nothing but through which the respiratory gases pass. That means the respiratory gases means nothing but oxygen. So the oxygen is dissolved in the water. So the water passage to reach the gills. So that is called respiratory tract. And respiratory tract is formed by three organs: mouth, buccal cavity, and pharynx. Then coming to the functional aspect. First of all, after discussing the structural aspect of the respiratory system, let us look at the functional aspect. Then in the functional aspect, first of all we shall deal with the mechanism of respiration. Then later on we shall deal with the physiology of respiration. So Scolyodon is aquatic. That means it lives in the water, that too in the marine water, that means in the sea and oceans. So it depends completely upon oxygen dissolved in seawater for its respiration. So its respiration is aquatic. And the respiratory organs, as we have discussed just now, are the gills. There are five pairs of gills are present. These five pairs of gills are present in gill pouches. Now we shall see in the diagram also these gill pouches. These gill pouches They are present in a series on either side in the lateral wall of the pharynx. And these gill pouches, they contain gills. 5 gill pouches are present in a series on either side in the lateral walls of the pharynx behind the hyoid arch. Each gill pouch is compressed anteroposteriorly. Now we shall see the figure. So in this figure, we shall see these are the gill pouches. See the branchial pouch or gill pouch. You can see here gill pouch. So this is the gill pouch and this is the gill pouch. Like this, many gill pouches are present, totally 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. 5 gill pouches are present on either side of the pharyngeal region behind the hyoid arch. So here hyoid arch is present, hyoid arch is present here. Okay, then behind the hyoid arch on either side of the pharynx, then gill pouches or branchial pouches are present, and these gills are present within the branchial pouches, and each gill pouch opens into the pharynx by a large internal branchial aperture. You can see here internal branchial aperture or internal branchial opening. You can see this internal branchial opening or internal branchial aperture. So this one and this, all these are internal branchial aperture. So each gill pouch opens into the pharynx internally by internal branchial apertures or internal branchial openings, and they open outside by a narrow vertical external branchial aperture, which otherwise is called as the gill slits. So you can see 1 to 5 external gill slits. Here you can see these are the closed ones. Now you can see these are the opens. On either side they are open. So this is the external branchial apertures, which are otherwise called as the gill slits. As there is no operculum is present in the cartilaginous fishes, as it is a cartilaginous fish, Scoliodon is a cartilaginous fish, no operculum covers the gill slits. Then, 2 adjacent gill pouches are completely separated from each other by a vertical fibromuscular partition, which is called gill septum. Okay, see. This is the gill septum. See, here all these are the gill septum. So this is fibromuscular, that is fibers and as well as muscular, and the each gill pouch is separated by this fibromuscular partition, or which is called as interbranchial septum or gill septum, simply interbranchial septum or gill septum. And the inner or pharyngeal border of each gill septum is supported by a cartilaginous visceral arch or gill arch with its slender branchial rays. The septum is covered by an epithelium and contains blood vessels and nerves, etc. We shall see in the next slide, we shall see the figure clearly, and the blood vessels and nerves also we shall discuss. The mucous membrane of the septum is raised into numerous horizontal. Say, we shall see, discuss now here. So here, I already said, each gill pouch communicates with the pharynx through internal branchial aperture and with the exterior through external branchial aperture, which is otherwise called as gill slit. Then, 2 adjacent gill pouches separated by gill septum or branchial septum. So let us see the gill structure clearly with the help of these figures. So the gill septum has gill lamellae, which are richly supplied with blood capillaries, that is highly vascular. Each septum bears one set of gill lamella on its anterior face and the other on its posterior face. Then each set makes a half gill called demibranch or hemibranch, while both the sets attached to a gill septum constitute a complete gill or holobranch. Now, in this figure, we can easily see or easily examine the full total 1 gill lamella along with the gill septum. So here, now you can see this is the gill septum interbranchial gill septum. So this is the interbranchial gill septum, and whose mucous membrane is raised into numerous folds called gill lamellae. So this is one lamellum, this is one lamella. So this is one gill lamella, this is one gill lamella. So also called gill filaments. These constitute the gill proper, and they are richly supplied with blood capillaries. And now each septum bears, now you can see each septum bears two sets of gill lamellae, one on its anterior face. See, this is the anterior gill lamella, this one, and the other on its posterior face. So this is posterior gill lamella, anterior gill lamella and posterior gill lamella. Each set makes a half gill called demibranch or hemibranch. So this is the septum. On either side of that, it is anteriorly one gill lamella is present. This is one hemibranch or demibranch, and this is one hemibranch or demibranch. Both the sets are attached to gill arch, and its gill septum constitute gill arch. See here, this is the gill arch. They are attached to gill arch. The posterior demibranch of a septum has longer lamellae. See, this is the posterior, and this is the posterior, which is longer than the anterior one. So posterior gill lamellum is longer when compared to the anterior one. A gill pouch. So this is the, now gill pouch means here, before that gill pouch is present here, like, and in the gill pouch this total structure is present. This is the total gill pouch, so in which this is present. And that means this is one gill pouch and this is one gill pouch, which are separated by this gill septum. And so the gill pouch thus contains two demibranchs belonging to two adjacent gills. So this is one demibranch and the other is another demibranch. We shall see in the next, the other figure you can see here in this. Okay, in this, so the gill lamella. So one gill lamella, this is the gill septum. That means this is the gill septum, and the gill septum on either side has two gill lamellae. On another anterior gill lamella and posterior gill lamella, we have seen that posterior gill lamella is longer than the anterior gill lamella, and each pouch and each gill, the branchial pouch has the one complete gill, but it belongs to, say for example, let us look at this is one gill pouch. So in this gill pouch, what is present? The posterior gill lamella of this gill and the anterior gill lamella of this gill are present in this. That means gill pouch contains two demibranchs belonging to two adjacent gills. I have cleared it. So in this scolodon, what happens is the first or the hyoid arch, this is the hyoid arch. So here this is, here hyoid arch is present. So the hyoid arch, in hyoid, the in scolodon, the hyoid arch bears only a demibranch. See here, this is only one demibranch is present here. Only one demibranch is present. It is not a holobranch. That means complete gill. So presence of one hemibranch and one hemibranch on anterior side of the gill septum, another demibranch on the other side, complete, that makes complete holobranch. Hyoid arch bears only a demibranch on its posterior face. The first four branchial arches bear holobranchs. So this is the first hyoid arch, which bears only hemibranch or demibranch, and this is first holobranch containing two demibranchs. Here second holobranch, third holobranch, fourth holobranch. So totally these are the four complete holobranchs and one demibranch. So though we call it as five pairs, but actually it is four and a half. Four complete gills, which are called four holobranchs, and one hemibranch or demibranch, which is attached to the hyoid arch. I would like to repeat this. Each interbranchial septum has two sets of branchial lamellae, one on the anterior and the other on the posterior face. The lamellae of the posterior set are longer than those of the anterior set. The two sets of lamellae which are present by the same interbranchial, which are separated by the interbranchial septum, constitute a complete gill. So this is called complete gill. Okay. So how many such gills are present? 1, 2, 3 and 4. So 4 such complete gills, which are called holobranchs, are present. A single set of branchial lamellae is regarded as a half gill, which is also called hemibranch or demibranch. A branchial pouch thus contains the posterior demibranch of one gill and the anterior demibranch of the succeeding gill. Now you can see. So a branchial pouch. So this is, let us suppose this is the branchial pouch. If this is the branchial pouch, what it contains? The posterior demibranch. This is the posterior demibranch of this gill and the anterior demibranch of this gill. So a branchial pouch contains the posterior demibranch of one gill and the anterior demibranch of the succeeding gill. The total gill equipment of scholiodon includes one demibranch borne by the posterior face of the hyoid arch and four holobranchs borne by the first four branchial arches. The fifth arch is gillless. See, this is the fifth arch which is gillless, which is called as the fifth one, which is called as the abranch. So this is the fifth one, which is called as abranch, which doesn't possess any gill lamellum. So the gills of scholiodon are lamelliform, as their lamellae are attached to the septa by the entire length. Now I already said each gill lamella, that means each gill, is highly vascular, that means supplied with blood vessels. So there are, blood is supplied to a gill by afferent branchial artery. This is the afferent branchial artery, and which supplies the blood to the gill lamella, each branchial lamella. The blood gets oxygenated while passing through the sinusoids and collects in vessels that join the efferent branchial arteries. So the blood is passed to the gill lamella, where in this process the blood is oxygenated, and then it is collected by the efferent branchial arteries. Efferent branchial artery. And that means each gill lamella has one efferent branchial artery. The afferent and efferent branchial arteries are present on each lamella. Afferent branchial artery supplies blood to the gill lamella, and efferent branchial artery collects the blood from the gill. We shall discuss the blood circulation when we discuss the course of blood circulation and process of respiration. Now let us go to the another figure. So in this figure you can see the transfer section of the gill, the transfer section of the scholiodon body, where it represents the respiratory system, and the gill pouch which is opened here, the half portion where the gill pouch is opened here, and half portion which is parts of the branchial arch and blood supply to gill lamellae. Now here in this B portion. So this is a 111, which is where we can see the gill pouch. This is the gill pouch, okay, and gill septum is, this is the gill septum and gill lamellae. How the gill lamellae are present like this. So throughout this gill lamellae, how the blood vessels and capillaries are present inside. Here, this side which can be shown here. So afferent branchial artery is present and efferent branchial artery is also present. Then they are supported by many cartilages. So here the pharyngobranchial cartilage, epibranchial cartilage, coracobranchial cartilage. So with the many cartilages are present, basibranchial cartilages, many branchial cartilages are present, coracoid cartilage. Okay, so I would like to say that these gill lamellae are richly supplied with the blood vessels. Now let us discuss the mechanism of respiration. So here the fish performs definite rhythmical breathing movements to pass a current of water through the branchial pouches. Now first of all, water is taken into the mouth, it passes through the internal gill slits and the water baths the gill lamellae completely and passes out of the external gill slits. So the breathing movements occur in two steps. We know that it is inspiration and expiration. In inspiration, what happens? Let us see. First of all, the mouth is opened. How the mouth is opened? Let us see. The floor of the buccopharyngeal cavity is pulled down due to the hypobranchial muscles. You can see the inspiratory muscles also. So the hypobranchial muscles, they contract. Due to the hypobranchial contraction of the hypobranchial muscles, the floor of the buccopharyngeal cavity is pulled down. That means buccal floor is depressed as well as pharyngeal floor is also depressed by the contraction of the hypobranchial muscles. See, the hypobranchial muscles are many types, like for example coracomandibular muscles, coracohyal muscles and coracobranchial muscles. All these constitute the hypobranchial muscles. And due to this, mouth is opened. At the same time, the external branchial apertures means the gill slits are closed by the contraction of the horizontal muscles of the interbranchial septa. So you can see inspiration. In the inspiration, what happens? The floor of the buccopharyngeal cavity is pulled down. How it is takes place? It takes place because of the hypobranchial muscles. The contraction of the hypobranchial muscle, just now I told you there are three types of hypobranchial muscles: coracomandibular, coracohyal and coracobranchial muscles. These are called, collectively called hypobranchial muscles. They contract. Due to that contraction, buccal cavity and pharyngeal cavity, whose floors are pulled down, so increasing the volume. So when the volume is increased, then pressure decreases. So due to this, the water outside the water rushes inside when the mouth is opened. At the same time, the horizontal muscles of the interbranchial septa, which are present, they contract. Due to that contraction, the external branchial apertures, that is gill slits, are closed, and the water that enters into the buccopharyngeal cavity through the open mouth. Then this water pushes through the mouth, enters into the buccal cavity as well as it enters into the pharyngeal region. Then at the same time, the pharyngeal region, the water enters into the gill pouches. Then next one is expiration. So at this time, the mouth is closed. Mouth is closed due to the adductor mandibular muscles, contraction of the adductor mandibular muscles. And at the same time, hypobranchial muscles relax. So due to this, the buccal cavity, floor of the buccal cavity and floor of the pharynx will be raised. Then at the same time, horizontal muscles of interbranchial septa are relaxed. Due to this, gill slits are opened. At the same time, pharyngeal constrictor muscles, they contract. Due to this, the pharynx will be closed, so the water cannot move into the pharynx. So what is the only place here? The water has to enter into the gill pouches. There is no way it doesn't move again back into the mouth. It doesn't go to the esophagus either. Then only the way is to enter into the gill pouches. So like that, the gill pouches, when the water enters into the gill pouches with force, and it baths both branchial lamellae. And during this process, the esophagus is completely kept closed by the contraction of its muscles. I told you pharyngeal constrictor muscles. So the water is checked to check the entry of water into it. That means esophagus cannot enter. The water cannot enter into the esophagus. The branchial pouches themselves also help in maintaining the respiratory current by alternate contractions and relaxations of the intrinsic muscles attached to the branchial arches in the rhythm with the pharyngeal movement. So while passing through the branchial pouches, the water washes the branchial lamellae. So the oxygen that is dissolved in water is separated from the deoxygenated blood only by a double layer of cells, namely the thin epithelium of capillary wall as well as cuboidal epithelium of branchial lamella. So two membranes, they are differentiated. Now in this inspiration and expiration, what is happening is inspiration. During the inspiration, all the process that takes place to draw the water from the outside into the mouth, then to the buccal cavity, then to the pharynx. So, and then during the expiration, what happens? Mouth is shut, closed, and the gill slits are opened. The esophagus is also closed. So the water has to enter into the gill lamellae, the gill pouches, to bath the gill lamellae. That is the only way. Now coming to the physiology of respiration. So what happens now? Just water is rushed into the gill pouches, thus bathing the branchial lamellae or gill lamellae. In the branchial lamellae, the blood flows opposite to the water current. So that the blood meets highest concentration of oxygen and the lowest of carbon dioxide. Now, fresh sea water entering the gill pouches contains oxygen dissolved in it. Then this oxygen of water passes by endosmosis through the thin capillary wall. Just now I told you there is a thin capillary wall and the cuboidal epithelium of the gill lamellae that will not check, but it allows the water to enter into the blood. This permits the diffusion of oxygen from the water into the blood and the carbon dioxide also from the blood into the water. So by exosmosis. So here what happens is, now the fresh sea water entering the gill pouches contains oxygen dissolved in it. The oxygen of the water passes by endosmosis through the thin capillary walls into the blood, and at the same time the carbon dioxide of the blood passes into the water by a process of exosmosis. So this is nothing but an external respiration. That means in the gills, in the level of gills or in the gill proper, what happens? The oxygen enters into the blood and the carbon dioxide from the gills is given out to the outside flowing water. So this process of gases exchange at the place of gills is called external respiration. Now then coming to the internal respiration. What is internal respiration? Once the blood is oxygenated now. So the blood, when it is oxygenated, the oxygenated blood circulates throughout the body. Then when it circulates throughout the body, oxygen is used by the tissues to oxidize foodstuffs, and in this oxidation of foodstuffs, carbon dioxide is produced as a byproduct and which is given to the blood. So this respiratory exchange, this gaseous exchange at the level of tissues, where from the blood the oxygen enters into the tissues and from the tissues the carbon dioxide enters into the blood, and this gaseous exchange at the level of tissues is called as the internal respiration. Sometimes what happens, at intervals, the direction of the respiratory water current is violently reversed also in order to clear the branchial lamellae if any foreign particles are attached to the branchial lamellae. So at the intervals, the direction of the respiratory water current is violently reversed so that the foreign particles are cleared from the branchial lamellae. Now in the scholiodon faces some of the problems during the breathing. So what are the, that means especially water breathing, as it is an aquatic animal, it faces some problems in the respiration. What are those problems? So how it clears it? Though it clears the all the problems, so especially we have to compare the air breathing animals and water breathing animals. So what happens in contrast to the air? In contrast to the air, water as a source of oxygen, it offers two problems especially. First problem is water is about 800 times denser than the air. So all fishes, including the scolodon, has to make a great effort to ventilate the respiratory surface. It has to make a great effort than the other air breathing animals. Now the second problem is water contains much less uncombined oxygen. Water contains much less uncombined oxygen than the air. Hence, a large amount of water is required to pass over the gills to fulfill the oxygen need. So this problem is more acute for scolodon as it has relatively small respiratory surface that absorbs only half of the oxygen content of the water passing over it. So that's why it has to pass large amounts of water, that is for the oxygen need, to fulfill the complete oxygen need, it has to pass large amount of water through the gills. So this is the main difference between the water breathing animals and air breathing animals. Some of the problems faced by the water breathing animals. Thank you.